This book is by the barber of Baha'u'llah, Ustad Muhammad Ali Salmani. And what it proves to me is that everybody in the Baha'i faith is important. This man was a very simple man, and his work was to be a barber. But he had the honor of being in some ways closer to Baha'u'llah than anyone else in the world, in a way. And another interesting thing about Salmani is this, that by means of this simple man and this account, this pilgrim account, Azal, the enemy of Baha'u'llah, is totally demolished, because this man simply puts paid to that evil half-brother of Baha'u'llah who tried so often to murder the manifestation of God. Now, the memories are extremely interesting. They're sort of American rags to riches in a way, because he begins as an orphan and takes care of his family and becomes very successful in his own line of work. But he was not only the barber, he also appreciated literature very much, and he wrote poems to Baha'u'llah because he was so much in love with him that he couldn't stay away from him. And I thought I'd read you just a few lines from some of his poems. O love, without thee, never can I rest, nor ever solve my mind's predicament, nor find a moment's peace within my breast. Thou stealest from the sugar all its sweet, and from the rose its red, with every smile of thine, and every blandishment. Surpassing musk of Tartary, the morning wind blows through thy hair, like ambergris the very air, like Jesus' breath the scent. What shall I say? How win the fray? What beggar at this threshold would consent to leave him so he could o'er all the earth hold sway? Now, this book is about Hanum, the most exalted leaf, the sister of Abdu'l-Bahá, and it was brought out to commemorate this year, which is the 50th anniversary of her leaving the world. And there are a number of little memories that I had of Hanum. For example, I told how she gave me my Baha'i ring that I've worn ever since. And she called some of the girls to her that were visiting at that time in the Holy Land, and very simply distributed a ring to each one. And this was the one that she gave me. And another thing I remember hearing her say was, when I told her there really is no happiness in this world, she said in reply, except in service to the cause of God. She did not like you to be gloomy. She liked people who would serve and who were active. And there was a very gloomy Persian lady there who was always retracing her sorrows. And one day, Hanum said to her, the world of sorrow is so wide that no matter how fast and far you gallop your steed, you will never get to the end of it. I've told it a little bit differently in the book. Now, speaking about translation, this book, the Salmani, is a translation from his original Persian. Translation is really choosing, because words have so many meanings. And I remember that in Haifa, even the Guardian would sometimes ask us at table which translation we preferred of, say, a certain term. For example, I remember him saying, do you prefer first point or primal point for the Bab? And of course, we all said primal point because of the alliteration. And another time, we were talking about the marriage verses, where, as you know, the bride and groom say the same thing, only in the Arabic, one is feminine, the other's masculine, but they are absolutely equal as man and wife. And they say, verily, we are all content with the will of God. That's the literal translation. But the Guardian said, really, what it meant was, we will all abide by the will of God. And then he looked at me and smiled and said, maybe we should translate it, resign to the will of God. We had many wonderful times at his table in Haifa, and that was long ago. He still smiled a great deal, laughed a great deal. And I remember one time when Fujita, the Japanese who was serving at table, even laughed out loud, because the Guardian was saying how well-behaved young Baha'is must be. And he was told that in Germany, the boys and girls shared the same dormitory at the summer school. And he said, oh, so they're even worse than the non-Baha'is. And then a German present said, oh, it's all right, Frau Braun is there. And the Guardian said, yes, but at the moment of temptation, Frau Braun might not always be there. And he said the thing to do was to avoid temptation. And he always wished the Baha'is to be exemplary and to lead others in their way of life. When Shoghi Effendi was very young and was on his way to Oxford, he stopped in France for a while because Abdul Baha wished him to rest. And we were able to be with him then. And my father was very much impressed with him. Of course, none of us had ever heard the word guardian in its Baha'i sense in those days. But father said, he is just like a diamond cut from a larger diamond. He has all the qualities. And father loved the French shops and the beautiful clothes and things like that in Paris. And he wanted to take Shoghi Effendi to Charvet, the great shirt maker. And Shoghi Effendi wouldn't go because he said, I might get to liking these things. And he dressed very simply, wore the trench coat, and wore the high Persian black hat because Abdu'l-Bahá wished him to. And this made him an object of great curiosity. And once when he went to the opera, we were told that it was, I believe, Samson and Delilah, but he was not pleased with what was going on the stage. And he rose and he walked out of the opera. And since the French always stared a great deal, you can imagine what that must have meant. And one time we were with him in the forest of Fontainebleau, and a group of French tourists came by, and one of the women saw him and said, that's the Shah of Persia, no? And I thought to myself, well, much greater than any Shah of Persia is this grandson of Abdu'l-Bahá. And sometimes we rode bicycles together. And I remember that once we were riding without hands, just Shoghi Effendi and I, and his bicycle caught in some sand and he almost fell off. And I thought, oh dear, I'm not taking proper care of Abdu'l-Bahá's grandson. And we were, of course, quite young at that time. And he laughed very much with my mother because he saw my sister and me take out a little so-called yellow leather-covered what he thought were prayer books. But then we opened them up and started powdering our noses, and he thought that was very amusing. And we were out in Barbizon with him in the wheat fields, and they were shot through with poppies and cornflowers. It was a very beautiful place, and he decided to take a picture of us all with him and by remote control, because he had a new gadget. He was very much interested in modern inventions, and he had a new gadget that would take our picture by remote control. And so we're standing there with him in the wheat fields and laughing because we're facing a camera with no photographer. Well, there are many memories. He told us that wine had never touched his lips. That was a time in the early days when Baha'is still thought they could drink in moderation, and nobody agreed just what moderation was. And so there was still wine on many Baha'i tables in those days. But of course, later we all gave it up because we wanted to set the example, and it's doing a great favor to the world if Baha'is abstain from alcohol, because alcohol has caused such untold misery in the world. And it really doesn't cost us much of an effort not to drink. And it's a gift that we can give to the world, which is that we don't use alcohol. He was always setting the example, Shoghi Effendi was. And you felt that you had a great leader. He was the general of the faith. And it seems that Napoleon has said that an army of deer headed by a lion is better than an army of lions headed by a deer. And whatever we were, we know that we were headed by a lion, and that it was Shoghi Effendi's generalship that established the faith worldwide. My father ran away from his home in Tehran to be with Abdu'l-Bahá and finally received permission when he was en route there and came through the Caucasus. And he had to travel steerage on the boat, and he was hungry, and he went through all kinds of things. And he took an oath that he would never sleep in a bed until he should come into Abdu'l-Bahá's presence. So finally, he got to Abdu'l-Bahá's place in the Holy Land, and he was afraid to go in and see Abdu'l-Bahá. And the friends sort of pushed him in and said, "You'll see, he's very easy to be with. You don't have anything to be frightened of." But Father went in after this long, long, weary journey and looked at Abdu'l-Bahá and fell in a faint. For one thing, he had never seen any picture except the youthful picture of Abdu'l-Bahá, and he thought that he was seeing Baha'u'llah, because already Abdu'l-Bahá's hair was turning iron gray, and this would have been only a very few years after Baha'u'llah left the world. And Abdu'l-Bahá had them take Father, give him some tea, bring him back to himself, and then right away Abdu'l-Bahá called him and said, "The cause of God has reached America. You know English, and we need translators." And he gave Father this huge batch of tablets. And Father looked at them and said, "But Master, how can I translate these? These are Arabic, and I am Persian." "Never mind," Abdu'l-Bahá said, "you will be able to do it." And he gave him a handkerchief full of rock candy that he had blessed with his own hands. He gave him this candy that we've kept bits of it in the family for ever since. And Father took it and became a very skilled translator of Arabic as well as Persian later. The Guardian wished the young Baha'is to be well educated, and he also wanted them to follow their own bent. For example, he asked me what subject I was interested in, and I told him literature. But he also asked me if I knew anything about astronomy, and I didn't know anything, so I took a year of it in college, and I still don't know anything about it. All I know is that we never see the back of the moon. And the only reason I know that is that I asked the astronomy teacher to illustrate, and she walked all around me with her back to me, and so I sort of got the point. And let me see. No, would that work out? Anyhow, with her face to me, she walked around. We never see the back. And I must say that my entire education was directly engaged into "Please, Shoghi Effendi." That was the only reason. And he told Father, "Give them the best in America." He wanted people to study and to learn. because it's very important, and anyone who reads the Advent of Divine Justice can see how much we need education if we're going to teach the faith adequately. So we have a motive for learning. Most American students don't have a motive or a reason, but we have a motive, which is to spread the faith of Baha'u'llah around the planet, because it makes this great claim that only the faith of Baha'u'llah can unify humankind and establish peace on earth. When the Guardian would write America and the American believers and would say how corrupt the situation was in this country, they sometimes would come to me and say, are we really that bad? This was years ago, but nobody says that anymore. Nobody says, are we really that bad? Especially since Tylenol and the fact that you can't walk out of your house or be in your house and be secure. All these things were prophesied long ago in the faith, and we believe that unless there is a spiritual rebirth of all humankind, the world will not be safe for humanity, and the war will finish us all off, and our social life will be completely destroyed. The Guardian told us the immediate future was very dark, but he said that the distant future, the later future, was very bright, and that there would be a golden age, and that there is no reason for Baha'is to be pessimistic, because all Baha'is suffer with the other people, but we suffer hopefully. They suffer often in despair because they think this is the end of everything, and to us it is the beginning of everything. And so we are not disturbed, and even if we die, it makes no difference. It's just Almighty God taking us out of one of his pockets and putting us in another of his pockets so that we are perfectly safe in any case. And that's why we need a spiritual light in our hearts, because materialism cannot give us enough hope to live by. Because Abdu'l-Bahá said that in a materialistic civilization, good and evil advance together and maintain the same pace. And that is why you need a plus quality, so that good will win out over evil.